Hi Ron, Chris here, and I've got Chewy's latest laptop that they sent out to me in exchange for the review you're watching right here. This one is called the CoreBook X Pro. Now it has a Core i5, it's the 8259U with Iris 655 graphics. This configuration has 8 GB of RAM, DDR4, it's 2.4 GHz, and a NVMe SSD, which is a 512 GB capacity. It's a Kingston drive. There's also a spare NVMe slot in this. It comes with Wi-Fi AC. Sadly, it's not AX. And the screen in this one, it's 15.6 inches, 144 Hertz IPS Full HD resolution. The battery capacity, it's Chewy's largest yet, 70 watt hours. Now in the box, what do we get? Well, we get an EU power cable, if you do get the EU version, of course. And this is our power supply, so it's really nice and small. So yes, DC charging, not type C. This one is rated to 65 watts. And we'll take a look at the weight. So the laptop has 1.81 kilos, and then you add the power supply and the cable, which you are going to need, of course, to lug that around. Total weight is just over 2 kilos. Now, just over 2 kilos, for a 15.6 inch laptop, that's not actually bad. Now the lid of this one, little tiny bit of flex, made out of alloy. This is where we have the metal just on the lid here, and it does curve around the lip over the edge to help protect that screen, 144 Hertz panel that we've got in it, full HD. So lifting it up one-handed, I can't. I need two hands for that, all right? And here we have our keyboard. So this one is backlit. The travel on it's a little bit short, about 1.4 millimeters. The spacing is okay. The keys are a little closer together than what we've seen on other Chewy laptops. Power button, separated away from the keyboard. This is good, so no accidental pressing of this. And if you just lightly tap it, nothing's going to happen. So you have to really push down quite hard for it to then register. So compromise with the arrow keys and overall, it is good. Now, I'll just show you the backlighting on this one. There you go, with the lights off, you can see it's a little uneven. It just bugs me that the backspace here and the caps lock brighter than the rest of the keys for some reason, but that's about it. Now, typing on it, I've had no problems, okay? No missed keystrokes, nothing strange going on. It's an okay keyboard, really no problem with it. So this is where it feels kind of weird, like it's not a Chewy laptop that I'm reviewing here. So we have a little bit of a red stripe around the outside that's painted on it. This is plastic, the side here. As I mentioned, it's just the lid that is the metal. SD card reader, USB 3.0. So this SD card reader, unfortunately, it's just USB 2 speeds. So it's not that great. It caps out at about 24, 23 megabytes per second. Gigabit LAN and a Kensington lock slot right there. And then over on the left side here, we've got some more ports. So type C. Now, unfortunately, this does not support video out. All right, that's a bit of a shame. Doesn't support power delivery either. So don't plug anything into it. You could risk it shorting out something. So there's a status LED. So if I flick this, that is to actually disable the webcam. This physical switch there will completely cut it out, which is great. That's hardwired. And along here, then we've got another two USB 3.0s. HDMI 2.0 specs, that's 4K 60. Okay, that's good. And then DC in for charging with a status LED. Now charge time on this, it's about 2.5 hours for the 70 watt hour battery. Along the underside, we have a lot of little rubber feet all around here. And what's great about this particular model here, the CoreBook X Pro, is this. RAM upgrades, easy access, panel, one screw, NVMe drive, so this is the 22x80. Now they were a bit of a pain to get out. The single screw is fine to screw it out, but it's just to unclip them. So there you can see we have a single SODIMM slot and then the 8 GB that is soldered into place. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm going to add 8 GB more so I can run this in dual channel just so we can see the possible performance, the maximum performance, especially when it comes to that Iris 655 graphics that this 8th gen chip has in it. Taking this off, you can see there is our main boot drive. This is a Kingston, and then the second slot right here. So we're able to swap out those SSDs. There is no reason for us to completely open this right up. So I've got an 8 GB stick here. This one is DDR4 2400 MHz from Lenovo. This, and I just slot it in. like that clips into place. And I just wanted to mention too, the backing material on this, so the underside, this is a very light alloy, very easy to scratch, but at least it is metal, gives it a bit of a better feel to it. And even these panels, those are made out of that alloy. So this is PCIe 3 spec, SATA 3 for the two M.2 SSD slots right there. It's a little bit of a space here, but not too bad. So for maintenance, you can just undo all the screws, you can pull this off, and you could blow out or use a vacuum to get dust out of those fans later on in a few years' time. So you can see our cooler right here. It does have two copper transfer heat pipes right there, and then there's the fin. So the cool air comes in from the bottom, is blowing, then out the back. And that's our sodium slot right here. Now, what's the bad news? The bad news is this is our wireless card. It's hidden under here, but it is soldered on to the motherboard. It's the Intel 3165, and that's just Wi-Fi AC. So it does not have Wi-Fi 6, unfortunately, which is, I think, a big mistake. And then now the screen. This one is a really strange choice from Chewy here to put a 144Hz panel into this particular laptop with this kind of spec. It really does need a dedicated GPU. It needs to be a gaming laptop, which this is not. So it's a full HD screen, so that's 1080p, it's IPS, matte coated, anti-glare. Maximum brightness, very disappointing. So it's actually currently on its peak brightness right now, and that is 213 nits only. So sRGB 66%, NTSC 48%, Adobe RGB of just 50%, and 50% P3. So a true disappointment in terms of screen quality in this laptop. It should be brighter. We should have better color coverage than this. And we've seen it in some of their other laptops. So this screen is a huge step backwards. And now the downwards firing speakers. So these ones, they sound okay. Here's a sample at 100%. They do lack in volume and bass. So it ships out with Windows 10 Home. Now it is fully activated, no problems with the license, none of those kind of issues that we had maybe about 5 years ago with some of these brands, long gone. Now if you look in the device manager, you'll see that under the Ethernet, we've got Realtek, okay? So gigabit, and then our wireless card, as I pointed out, is very disappointing. Non-upgradable, the Intel AC card here, so the 3165. Now, really, they should have gone with the AX200. Wi-Fi 6 card would have been so much better. The internal storage that we've got with this one, the 512 gigabyte NVMe drive, PCIe 3.0 spec. The speeds here, you can see, it gets around 1500 for reads. Writes are okay, but for an NVMe drive, it's a little slow, and it should be a little bit better than this. It's only a basic entry-level Kingston drive from them. So if you want faster, get yourself something like the Samsung 970 Evo Plus. Now, the general performance of this laptop, I won't go into spreadsheets documents because the Core i5 here, the 8259U, handles everything just fine. Start menu, no lag. I've got a bit of applications and things opened here in the background. But what I wanted to show is 4K footage here. Is it going to drop frames in YouTube? This is with Chrome. So I'll go into full screen, enable our stats there. And okay, 16 drop frames out of almost 2000 now that I've been playing this clip back. That's actually pretty good. So really, most of the video you will throw at it. So H.264, HEVC, VP9 codecs, all playable, not a problem with this chipset. Whatever you throw at it is going to be great there performance. So a couple of little benchmarks here that I do have that I wanted to show you. So this is Geekbench 5. The score's okay. I have seen over 1,000 for single core score and close to 4,000 with this particular configuration. Well, with this chipset. So it's still okay. This is an okay score, but starting to fall behind a little bit now. The 11th gen certainly are quite a bit quicker than this. And integrated graphics performance. So this is Night Raid here. Just to show you, you can run this on your own hardware, this particular benchmark if you wanted to, or Geekbench. You can see that, again, it's an okay score, And this is our Cinebench R23 score, so 2,684 points. I have been monitoring the thermals every time I've been running all these different benchmarks and gaming and whatnot. I've had it running in the background, HW Info. So what have we gotten up to here with the thermals? This is always a bit of a concern here. Hot, okay, so 91 degrees is what it will get up to on that 8259U. So it's a hot chip, and it gets a little loud with the fan noise. So maximum wattage it's pulling here, according to HW Info, is around about 50 watts at peak. So yes, thermal throttling did take place, throttled down those clocks a little bit there. So if you undervolt, which you might be able to do, well, you should be able to do that through the BIOS, you can probably lower those temperatures down a little bit and help boost the performance. Here's a sample of the fan noise now. Exactly what it sounds like under load. And now our webcam. So this one is 720p max. It has dual array microphones. And the quality, as you can see, in standard kind of lighting here. So I turned off my powerful studio lights and what I would call a normal ambient level of lighting here. Not great at all. And when you type on the keyboard, you can hear a little bit of that noise coming through. So poor webcam, but at least we do have one with the CoreBook X Pro. Now this speaker PC can edit video. This is 4K Adobe Premiere Pro, and my clips here are from my Sony A6400. So they're 4K, 100 megabits per second. And the timeline here is okay. It's not super fast. Playback is at least here just running at the quarter playback resolution. That's fine. And even if you set it to half or full, I probably wouldn't run, but half, not really dropping any frames. So that's good there. What about the export times? So what I'll do is my standard test here, which is always 1 minute of the YouTube preset. Okay, so that's the YouTube 4K preset there selected. And we'll see how long it's going to take to export that. Start on the timer, export. And it shouldn't take too long. You can see it's going through it relatively quick here. The Iris Pro graphics will aid this. Okay, it finished up there at approximately 1 minute and 22 seconds or so, which is not too bad for this spec of 8th gen CPU. Now onto the fun part. So they claim that it can be a bit of a gamer, right? A gaming machine? Well, not really. I mean, this is The Witcher 3 on the lowest possible settings, 720p, and it's struggling. We're getting around 30 frames per second, but there are some noticeable lags and dips. Now, here in the town is where I always test because there's a lot of NPCs around. There's a lot to render out in the countryside with this game. The frame rate does improve, but really it's a little too choppy here for my own liking. I would like to see, well, ideally, of course, around 60 frames per second, which we're just not going to be able to get out of a demanding game like this. Look at that, just down to 19 frames per second. So not ideal, but I'll try something a little lighter, which is Counter-Strike, not as heavy as The Witcher 3 here. So this one I set to 1080p on the lowest possible settings, and we're getting around 80 frames per second, which, yeah, it's okay, but we can't really take full advantage of the 144Hz screen with this kind of hardware. Ideally, we need a dedicated GPU with this, don't we? We needed like an RTX, I don't know, like a 3050 Ti or something would be perfect with this screen, which we simply don't have. So I'm just gonna run out here and see if I can get any shots, get lucky. I think someone's shooting at me right then. Probably won't last long at all. Oh, bad time to reload. Anyway, you can see that it's not really an ideal gamer at all. Not with this kind of spec. Even though the Iris 655 graphics was good about 3 years ago for integrated, it's now a little bit dated. And finally, Linux. This is working well, so the brightness, the volume, everything, Bluetooth, wireless, all working.
Now, battery life. I've got some good news in that area. Because of the 70 watt hour battery, which is Chewy's largest ever that I've come across in one of their laptops, normally they're only like 39 watt hours, and a lot of the tech they have, especially with the old Gemini Lake and the Apollo Lake and everything like that, this one's big. So if you put the screen onto 60 hertz, if you don't need the 144 hertz for the desktop, for your web browsing and things like that, it's well worth it because then you can get around 8 hours of light use. Now I'm talking to just like streaming YouTube, okay? Very, very light there. That's not bad, it's not bad, okay? But when you have it on 144 hertz, you're doing, again, light work, that brings it down to about 6 hours, 5.5 really, that you're able to squeeze out of it. So it does take a toll on that battery life. Now it's a really odd combination for me, this kind of spec, to have a 144 hertz screen doesn't really make any sense at all, because if it had an RTX 3050 in it, or a 3060, and they, okay, yeah, fair enough, you're gonna be playing your games, high frame rate, high refresh rate, right? But the iris 650 graphics in this, as you saw, The Witcher 3, it's an old title now, but it's still very demanding, but hey, 30 frames per second. And even Counter-Strike, it's not gonna be at 144 frames per second to take advantage of the screen. The screen is my biggest complaint. I mean, the brightness, I measured it again. It did get a little brighter, around 230 nits. But that's it, that's the peak brightness for whites. Not exactly amazing. The color coverage there, terrible. 50% Adobe RGB, not good. So anyone who wants to edit video or color grade or photos, not the screen for that, not for professionals, not for professional use, no. The average Joe, the daily computing, however, performance is great from the Core i5. It is very good, it's quick, it's snappy. We have an NVMe SSD, it's not SATA 3. Easy to add another 8 gigabytes of RAM, which I highly recommend doing. You can easily add another SSD, SATA 3, 22x80, that's good. But then there's a few other things. Speakers are poor, webcam is poor, and the thermals, it gets up to 91 degrees Celsius. It also does trigger thermal throttling, okay? And then the wireless card, that's a big one for me. If I could upgrade the wireless card, it wouldn't be so much of an issue, but I'm stuck on wireless AC. Old tech, okay? I want Wi-Fi 6 spec, and we should have the Intel AX200 in this, but we simply don't, and you cannot swap it out, which is a real shame there. So this could have been a really good laptop, I think, from Chewy. If we had a better screen, if we had maybe 10th gen or 11th gen CPU in this, and priced a little bit better with the wireless AC. So pricing wise, it's just under 500 euros, which I find is a bit of an ask considering the overall spec. Other positives though, build quality does seem to be pretty good. The hinge seems fine. It is lightweight, it's thin, I do like it. It's like an old Acer laptop to me, or maybe an MSI, very, very similar there. So there we go, now you know the full story of the Chewy CoreBook X Pro. Thank you so much for watching this review. I do hope to see you with more up and coming videos in the channel. Bye for now.